the children are making their way to the birthday party for Jesus, I would invite you to turn in your Bibles. You're going to be looking for the Gospel of Luke. It is the second book of the New Testament. The New Testament is about two-thirds of the way through the Bible. I'm going to be in chapter 2. Luke 2, 8 through 20. Hear the words of the Lord. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over the flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign to you. You will find the babe wrapped in clothes and lying in a manger." And suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told about them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had seen and heard, which were just as they had been told. May the Lord add his blessing to the reading of his word. There's a few guests with us today, okay, so I need to clue them in, okay? If you're a guest with us, if you are new here, if you haven't been around a lot during Advent, they're all waiting on me to talk about what I thought about the movie on Friday, okay? I know they are, because they caught me in the hallways this morning, in the parking lot this morning. They're sitting there right now with bated breath. Right, or whatever the phrase is, waiting for me to give my review or talk about how it was sort of like a life-changing experience or something to that effect. I don't think I can reach that bar, okay? I don't think I can do enough justice. That, alongside the fact that I was avoiding all of the spoilers, and I mean, if there was a headline that had Star Wars in it leading up to the movie being released, I avoided it, okay? So, I don't want to do that to anybody. It was wonderful. It was great. But instead, I want to tell you a little bit about going to the movie, okay? We got our tickets, like I told you, months ago, and the Coates family, we went with the Jacks, and we went with part of the Robkin family to the movie, and I was so nervous that I was going to have to sit on the front row and look like this when I barely go to movies at all, and much less this movie, and so Kylie and I went about 2 hours early to get in line. Now you're laughing at me, there were people ahead of us. Okay? Now we get to the movie theater there on Woodway Drive, Regal, and lo and behold, there was a cameraman from a TV station out in front. And so I want to show you what KCAN, is that the name of it? Let's just watch.
Force Awakens could be the highest grossing movie of all time, and the reviews so far have been pretty positive. Fans came out in force in Waco today and can hardly contain their excitement.
What are you going to do? All right, so yes, they came and they got this cute kid who's going to pull out a lightsaber here in just a second. Wow, that's great. And give her little thoughts about going to the movie. But then see who they caught after the little girl.
A lightsaber.
Yeah.
And it's very, very
purple. I'm just really stoked and...
Okay, so that's really, I can't believe it. I can believe it. It's just how it needed to happen. Well, okay, so we talked for a lot longer than that. We got our 15 seconds literally of fame there. But, you know, I've been telling you all along while I've been preaching about this, right, that I'm not the only one. That I am most definitely not the only one. Because, well, they got another family on camera, too.
On our website, KCEN TV. Never been to one at the theater before. My father took me when I was, I think, 3 to see Star Trek's back at the theater, and it was like the most awesome thing ever. And so I've been waiting for them old enough to go and see one at the movie as well.
Fans lucky enough to be on tonight's show.
I'm telling you, the force is strong in Central Christian Church. the only thing I would say is you should go see it, and that's actually not significant for me to say, because I don't do a whole lot of movie reviewing, or I don't do a whole lot of recommending of things and culture, because, well, you just never know. I mean, it hits different people in different ways, but you should go see it. Even if, you know, you weren't waiting in line 2 hours earlier, got on TV. Alright, so I don't do a lot of necessarily encouraging of that. What I do try to do is a little encouraging of looking at and studying God's Word. And that's what we're really doing. And so a couple thoughts. In a clip I showed you last week, there was this quote from Yoda to Luke, looking for someone, found him, you have. And apparently, some of the feedback I got is I didn't make a really strong connection between wars not make one great and being a peacemaker. Seems pretty straightforward to me. I think it was mainly this row that wondered what I was doing there. But wars not make one great, be a peacemaker. Seems pretty straightforward. I'm not trying to do some in-depth study of Star Wars. I'm only taking a quote or a snippet or a piece and then really applying it to the true lesson. Same thing with this one. Looking for someone, found him, you have. That describes the shepherds. That describes the shepherds. After the lights went on and they saw the angels in the sky, the angelic chorus that said, I bring you good news of great joy that shall be for all people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born. He is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign to you. You will find the baby wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger. Linus does that really well. And we know that, and we've studied that, and we've heard that year after year after year. And yes, they then went to go see, they went to go look for this baby, for this someone that the angels had told them about. And then they found him in a manger, wrapped in cloths. It's what happens next that I wanted you to give just a minute or two of attention to this morning. It says, let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that happened. So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what they had seen. One of the things that I love about the shepherds and angels, and especially the shepherds, is there is a sense of urgency. There is a sense of urgency. The word here is hurry. They hurried off. Okay? Then they went and told others about what they had seen and heard. They knew something significant happened, and just the pace of the story and the almost breathlessness in which they wanted to tell others about the story. The breathlessness and the hurry and the urgency in which they wanted to go and spread the word. So this is pretty simple this morning. Do we have that same sense of urgency? Do we have the same sense of urgency when it comes to going and spreading the word about what we have seen and heard? I don't think we do. And I think there's reasons we don't, okay? Some of the ones that I hear that come up quite a bit are, everyone I know already goes to church. I don't know who I talk to. That's one obstacle, I suppose. I think this idea, telling others about Jesus, it invades comfort zones a lot. I think I understand why that is, because religion falls in the same category, right, as politics or other things. It's just not polite talk most of the time, right? And so we avoid it. We don't talk about it a lot. And so I would say, for the most part, no. Let's just not even really. I know I could probably find exceptions, and you could probably think of exceptions, but let's just say, for the most part, we don't have a sense of urgency when it comes to this at all. But I want to point out just one thing in the text to you, okay? In verse 15, it says, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." Okay, so God told the shepherds about what had happened. Thing the Lord had told us about. Then in verse 17, when they had seen him, they spread the word. The Lord told us, then they went and spread the word. That phrase, "the Lord told us," and then the phrase, "spread the word," is the same word in the original language this was written. Same word. It's almost like God told the shepherds something, counting on them to then go and tell others what God had told them about. Now, friends, the new question is, what if God has told you about his son with the expectation that you will have some urgency to go tell others about what you have seen and heard? Is that a game changer at all? If it's not, should it be? I get it. There's obstacles to doing this. This has come up in a lot of sermons. It's nothing new. I think maybe the reason why we don't have a sense of urgency about going and telling is, I don't know, we've seen others with certain strategies that turn us off, right? I have a friend, and I quote him a lot. I don't always tell you I'm quoting him, but I trust him. I trust his research, and I trust his scholarship. And he's a pastor in Dallas. His name is Justin. One of the things that Justin does is he engages in debates. He recently debated one of the most known atheists in the country at Collin County Community College in Plano, and they live streamed it and all these different things, and he was talking about it. I was reading on his Facebook page how much time he had spent getting ready for this. And you know, what I notice, whenever Justin posts something, he will, in the comments section of something that he posts, it's almost like he has a debate every time there too. He engages so many different people, and it's almost like he debates them. And one of the reasons I admire him so much is because he has read enough and he is intelligent enough that he can he can reason someone, he can debate someone into a saving relationship with Jesus Christ. And that's great for Justin. I would put him in the category of about 1 in 1,000 that are able to pull that off. for the other 999 out of 1,000 of us that probably get a little nervous if we're called to count on what we've read or what we can think of on our feet in the moment, or what we can reason out when we're presenting what we've seen and heard. And if that strategy in general of arguing or debating or discussing, if we don't want to give it such a negative connotation, if that turns us off anyway, and I think maybe it does because so many of us are on the other side of the coin, we have our own doubts and we have our own confusions about the faith, and so when someone presents that tactic to us of trying to argue with us or trying to convince us, it's such a turnoff, isn't it? So if that particular strategy of telling others what we've seen and heard is not one that really fits with you, well, let me offer to others by your example and by your love. By your example and by your love. Now, if you want to talk about things that convict and you want to talk about strategies that are compelling, well, now I think we're on to something. Because friends, let's talk about the first one. Be an example. People are watching you. Oh my goodness, people are watching you just by virtue of the fact that you come in here on Sunday mornings on a regular basis, and you engage in things like Bible studies, and you have Christian friends, and church life is important to you, and you've let the world know that it is. By virtue of that, people are watching you. How do you order your life? What are the decisions you make? What are your priorities? They're watching. They are watching, and I think the world doesn't need any more lectures anyway, but I do think the world needs more pictures. They need a picture of what it looks like to live with hope. And they need to see someone that has joy in their life. And they need a picture of what it looks like to follow Christ. That's a fantastic way to go and tell. And the other way is just to love. Just love. Love abundantly. Love lavishly. Love recklessly. Love foolishly. Jesus used the language, love your enemies. Talk about something that's kind of hard to get our minds around. But that's the idea. Just love. And you know what that means, right? That means things like, well, you're going to have to be patient when you don't feel like being patient. You're going to need to be kind when that person doesn't deserve kindness. You're going to need to forgive when it is so very difficult to forgive, because that's what love is. Putting the needs and concerns and welfare of others ahead of your own is sacrifice. So we look at these shepherds, and like when we looked at Mary, like when we looked at Joseph, there's something that's a part of their story, something that's a part of what they did, the decisions they make, the actions they took, that is impressive, inspiring even. With these folks, it's this sense of urgency that God had told them something, and now they go and tell others. Asking ourselves, do we have that same degree of urgency? And then thinking, well, I don't necessarily, because I don't know how well. I've offered two possibilities, by your example and by your love. And we have an example of love, don't we? I told you last week when I read the scripture that you really just find the Christmas story in Matthew and Luke and in the first 14 verses of the Gospel of John. Well, actually, you also get a little bit of the Christmas story in 1 John. This is love. That God sent his Son, that we might live through him. Let's go and tell. Let us pray. Great and gracious God, my prayer to begin is that as with any time we gather, as with any Sunday, that we are comforted and convicted, that we are challenged and encouraged, not by my words, but by your word. So Lord, I pray that yes, there has been some encouragement this morning, some encouragement to consider the urgency we have in telling others about your Son, Jesus Christ. It sure seems like this night shift, these shepherds had that sense of urgency. And sure, they had the benefit of an angelic chorus and the sky lighting up, but we have had the benefit of experiencing you too. So we really have no excuse. Lord, challenge us.